A very good evening to our saints. Thank you so much for joining us for our Wednesday service this evening. We thank God for the opportunity just to always be together, even in seasons like this, as we share the word of God and as we look into the scriptures. As we have been looking at the scriptures, we've been talking about our appropriate response to our challenges, which is prayer. The Bible says in James chapter number 5 verse 13, is anyone in trouble, let him pray. I am convinced from the word of God that as a church and as a people, we must be in prayer and we must continue to pray, because there is an answer for us. But that answer is hidden in the place of prayer. The Bible says, if my people that are called by my name humble themselves and pray and leave their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. So I believe strongly that if we continue in prayer, there is an answer for our nation. There is an answer for the challenges that the world is facing right now. But it rests upon the shoulders of a praying church, amen. Praying individuals that make up the body of the church, amen. And so I'm believing that as we have been praying and as we continue to pray, there is an answer that God is releasing in our world in response to our prayers, to the prayers of the righteous, amen. And I trust that God is keeping you safe and strong, and that you're continuing steadfast in prayer, and that you shall see the thing that you have been praying for in this season. This evening, we just want to continue to share in the word of God, and we continue to encourage each other to pray. And this evening, we have just titled our message, Praying for Effect, amen. Praise the Lord. And our text is from the book of James, chapter number 5, and I'll read from verse 16. The Bible says, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. That effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the earth for the space of 3.5 years. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit. Praise the name of Jesus. The New Living Translation translates verse 17 as saying, Elijah was a human, Elijah was as human as we are. And yet when he prayed earnestly that no rain would fall, none fell for 3.5 years. Praise the name of Jesus. The Amplified Version translates verse 17 and says, Elijah was a human being with a nature such as we have, with feelings, affections, and a constitution like ours. And he prayed earnestly for it not to rain, and no rain fell on the earth for 3 years and 6 months. Praise the Lord. Today's English version says, Elijah was the same kind of person as we are. He prayed earnestly that there would be no rain, and no rain fell on the land for 3.5 years. And lastly, the Bible in basic English would translate that verse saying, Elijah was a man of flesh and blood as we are, and he made a strong prayer that there might be no rain, and there was no rain on the earth for 3 years and 6 months. And we're talking about praying for effect. Praise the Lord. Effect is basically a change which is a result of an action, or a change which is the result of a consequence. Praise the Lord. And so we're talking about prayer that produces a change, prayer that has consequences. Praise the name of Jesus. Many times people pray for different reasons, and sometimes, not all the times, but sometimes people pray and they don't expect any answers to come as a result of their prayers. Many times people pray as a duty with no expectation, with no reasonable expectation of an answer to their prayers. They're just praying for the sake, because this is what Christians must do. Christians pray. Praise the name of Jesus. It pacifies their conscience to feel that, you know what, I have prayed about it and I've left it in the hands of God. We prayed about it. Amen. Hallelujah. Some may feel prayers some may feel that the prayers are of a more spiritual person, are more effectual, and so they tend to outsource prayers. Amen. because they feel that their prayers will not bring the desired consequence or effect. Amen. So many people in the church outsource prayers on the most important things of life because they feel that, you know what, I cannot be the one to pray for this. I need someone who has a direct connection with God, who has favor with God, a more righteous person than I am, who will pray for this thing and bring the desired results. And the consequence of that is that many of the things that must be changed by our prayers remain unchanged. We have failed to convert the potential of our prayers into effect because we do not trust our own prayers and we outsource prayers from other people. And many times those people who say that I will pray for you, once one person says, when someone tells you that I'm going to pray for you, that's the prayer. Amen. Hallelujah. Many people don't follow through on that prayers when they say that they're going to pray for you. So many people outsource prayers. Amen. And there's no effect on their lives because people many times don't pray after they say, I'm going to pray for you. When they say that, then that's the prayer for you. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. And so as a nation and as a church, as a people, we have been robbed of the potential of the effects of the prayers of the saints because many of the saints of God are not praying for the purposes of effect, and some are not even praying because they don't believe that their prayers will bring forth any change or any effect in the situation. So people are looking at the nation and they're thinking that, what will my prayer do in the context of the largeness of the pandemic that we're going through? And you look at yourself and you look at the challenges that are going on in the world and you feel that, you know what, my prayers, I don't think they can make any difference. This thing requires prophetic apostles, amen, to pray and cause a change. Praise the Lord. Amen. But James, writing to the church, gives us an insight of how God would want us to pray and the kind of person that can pray a prayer that brings an effect in a nation, effect in a church, effect in a family, effect in their own individual lives. Amen. The Bible talks about, James talks about the prayers or the effective prayer of a righteous man. Hallelujah. Making power available. And then he gives an illustration of Elijah, a man just like us, who prayed and the heavens were shut, and prayed again and the heavens were open. Hallelujah. And so the Bible here, let me just get right into it, talks about the prayers of the righteous making power available. Now the Bible qualifies the kind of prayer who must the kind of person who must pray a prayer that prevails and has effect. Amen. The Bible does not say that when you pray prayer, it does not say that prayers have effect and have make tremendous power available. That's not what the scripture says. It doesn't just lump up and say that if it's a prayer, it has effect. If it's a prayer, it has power. It specifies that the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man. Amen. So there is a particular kind of person who prays prayers that have effect. That person, the Bible calls him a righteous man, the prayers of a righteous man, not just the prayers of a man, not just the prayers of a woman, not just the prayers of a child, but the prayers of a righteous man. Praise the Lord. And so we have to dissect this righteous man to find out what kind of a man is this righteous man. Hallelujah. Because if we can find such a man, that is the man that can pray a prayer that produces effect. Hallelujah. In the Bible, in the book of Isaiah 64 verse 6, the Bible says that, but we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousness are all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags, and as we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind have taken us away. So the Bible says that we all are as an unclean thing, and our righteousness is as filthy rags. So there is no one who is righteous, says the book of Romans, not one. Amen. Praise the Lord. Our righteousness is as filthy rags before God. So where can we find a righteous man if our righteousness is as filthy rags? Amen. Praise the Lord. When you read the New Testament, you find in the book of Romans chapter number 1 verse 17, it says, "For in the gospel a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith." So the Bible teaches us that in the gospel there is a righteousness that is unveiled, a righteousness that is revealed. It means that people did not know about this kind of righteousness. They were not aware that a man can be righteousness outside of his works and his efforts. So the Bible say that there is a righteousness in the gospel that is revealed, amen, a righteousness that is by faith, amen. Now when we're talking about righteousness, we're talking about being in right relationship with someone, being in right relation with one who has been put with someone. So we're saying that we are in a right, the prayers of a person who has been put right with God, the prayers of a person who is in a right standing with God. Praise the Lord. And the Bible says that in the gospel a standing that is right with God is revealed, a standing that is by faith, which means that in the gospel our standing and our right standing with God is not from our own works. The Bible shows us that there is a righteousness that is of faith that we receive by faith. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter number 5 verse 21 says, "God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Hallelujah. The Bible says that Jesus had no sin. He took our sin and became sin, and he gave us the righteousness that he had. So we become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, because Jesus took our sin and he gave us his righteousness. So we are in right standing with God because of what Jesus did on the cross, not because of what we have done or the things that we continue to do. The Bible shows us that in the gospel there is a righteousness that is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith, a faith that stands that Jesus took our sin and he gave us his righteousness. So we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Amen. In the book of Isaiah 54 verse 17, the Bible says that there is no weapon that is formed against thee that shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. And so our standing even in with God, and our standing against our enemies is based on our righteousness, which comes from God, not in our own righteousness. So when we say that there is no weapon that is fashioned against us that shall prevail, it's not because we are more righteous than all other people. Our righteousness is of God, says the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. So in Romans chapter number 5 verse 17, the Bible says that, "For if by the trespass of one man death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ." So the Bible tells us and shows us that the prayer of the righteous man is the one that prevails. And Isaiah says that it's not our righteousness, because our righteousness is as filthy rags. Then shows us that in the gospel there is a righteousness that is of faith that is revealed. Hallelujah. And Paul goes on in Romans 7 number 5 to say that that righteousness is a gift which is received. They that receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Christ Jesus. So the righteous man the Bible is talking about is every believer who has believed in Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Because that's what the Bible says, that he became sin so that we may become the righteousness of God. Amen. And who are we who have become the righteousness of God? But them that have believed that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Jesus died for our sins and was resurrected for our justification. We, every believer in Christ Jesus, is a righteous man. Hallelujah. Because righteousness is a gift from God. Our own righteousness is as filthy rags. Amen. And it does not give us traction in prayer. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. That's why when that man went before God and said that, "I am not like this man who is a sinner. I am not like this this man. I tithe twice. I tithe all my income. I'm not like this man. I pray and I fast twice a week. Hallelujah. He went away and he was not justified, because our righteousness and our standing in prayer is not based on what we do, but it's based on our right standing that is given to us by faith in Jesus Christ. So every believer, if you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, if you believe that Jesus died for your sins, if you believe that Jesus was raised on the third day for your justification, you are the righteous man the Bible is talking about, who can pray a prayer with effect. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. The Bible goes on to say the second thing. He said that the prayers of the righteous man, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man. Hallelujah. So we have a righteous man, but there is a kind of prayer that the righteous man prays which has effect. Hallelujah. The Bible talks about an effectual fervent prayer. It's not just talking about a prayer. Say, it doesn't just say that the prayers of a righteous man. It talks about the kind of prayer that the righteous man must pray to bring forth effect. Talks about the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man. The Amplified puts it in this way: the earnest, heartfelt, continued prayer of a righteous man makes tremendous power available, dynamic in its working. These are prayers that are prayed with feeling. Amen. Hallelujah. They are prayers that come from the heart. They are the cry of the heart that are given expression by our words. Hallelujah. Some people just pray prayers, amen, from their mouth. This is when people say that, let's say our prayers, amen. It's a prayer that is coming from the mouth and not from the heart. Praise the name of Jesus. Someone can say, God bless you, or I love you, and it's just a word that is coming from their mouth and not from their heart. So it's possible to speak something that does not come from your heart, amen. But the Bible is talking about a heartfelt prayer, a prayer that comes from the depths of your heart, amen. A prayer that comes forth with feeling, with emotion, with intensity. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. He's talking about the heartfelt prayer of a righteous man. It's not just prayers that we're talking about here, prayers that bring forth effect. We are not just saying that let's pray or say your prayers. We're saying that pray with feeling. Have a heartfelt prayer. Amen. Hallelujah. Have a fervent prayer in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And so these are prayers that one prays while they are in their prayers. Amen. Hallelujah. I don't know if you've ever been in prayer and you're praying and your mind is wandering and is organizing your day while you're praying. You're praying, you're bringing forth words. You may even be praying with your spirit and you're praying in tongues and your mind is wandering. Amen. You're praying in a prayer meeting or in your own home, and you're praying and you're looking at things around you. You are not in your prayer. Amen. Hallelujah. Your mind is wandering, but the Bible is not talking about that kind of prayer. It's talking about the effectual fervent prayer, a heartfelt prayer where you are in your prayer. Hallelujah. That you can't separate your prayer from yourself. You are in the prayer. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. You are right in there. Amen. You are logged in to your prayer. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. This is not the saying kind of prayers. Say your prayers. No. This is the heartfelt prayer. It is the cry of the heart. Praise the name of Jesus. It is the same cry that Rebecca said, give me a child or I die. It's something that comes from the heart with feeling, a prayer that will not let go. Hallelujah. Because it is coming from the depths of your heart. Amen. Hannah seemed as though she was drunk while she prayed that kind of prayer. And Eli the priest came to her and says, you know what? You are full of wine. Why are you so full of wine? And she says, no. I am not full of wine. She was a woman in prayer. And the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter number 1 verse 15, and Hannah answered and said, no, my Lord, I am a woman of a sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but have poured out my soul before me. Hallelujah. She was not saying prayers. Hallelujah. The Bible says that she said that I poured out my soul. Other versions will say that I have poured out my heart. Amen. Praise the Lord. It was such an intense prayer that the priest said that this woman must be drunk because she was so intense
intoxicated by the feeling that was in her heart, and she poured it out in prayer, and the man child was the result, the effectual fervent prayer. Hallelujah. These are not just prayers, amen, where we go through the motions, amen. Hallelujah. It's the kind of prayer that Jesus prays in the Garden of Gethsemane, and his sweat tends to be like clots of blood, amen. Hebrews 7 number 5 7 verse 7 says, during the days of Jesus life on the earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Hallelujah. He offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It's not the smart kind of prayer that even Jesus, the Son of God, the Bible says, when he was praying with feeling, he was praying with emotion. Hallelujah. Fervent prayers that were offered up with cries. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. The Bible said that the effectual fervent prayer, it's a prayer that comes from the depths of the heart. Amen. It's a prayer that comes with emotion. It's a prayer that comes with intensity. You put all of you into your prayer. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. And the Bible said the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man. So we have the righteous man, and we have the kind of prayer that makes effect. It is a fervent prayer, fervency in our prayers. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Now James gives us an illustration of a man who prayed with effect, and he calls that man Elijah. The Bible says Elijah was a man like us, and he prayed and the heavens were shut, and he prayed again and the heavens were open. Amen. Praise the Lord. One man prays over a nation, and a nation is held at ransom by the prayers of this man. He prayed and he went away for 3.5 years, and no man could do anything about it. Amen. He didn't call for a national day of prayer. Hallelujah. He just prayed on his own, and the heavens were shut. And when they needed the heavens to be opened, they didn't call for another national day of prayer. It was one man who prayed, and the heavens were open again. Praise the name of Jesus. He prayed with feeling. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. In 1 Kings chapter number 18, verse 42, we are shown how this man prayed. Amen. He says, so Ahab went off to eat and drink, but Elijah climbed to the top of Carmel, bent down to the ground, and put his face between his knees. Go and look toward the sea, he told his servant. And he went up and looked. There is nothing there, he said. Seven times Elijah said, go back. The seventh time the servant reported a cloud as small as a man's hand is rising from the sea. Hallelujah. So Elijah said, go and tell Ahab, hitch up your chariot and go down before the rain stops you. Hallelujah. This is Elijah who is praying for rain to come down. When he called for rain to stop, we didn't see how he prayed, but on the time that he's praying for rain to come down, we realize the kind of prayers that this man prays. He goes up into the mountain. The Bible says that he puts his head between his knees and begins to pray. Hallelujah. He prays with intensity. He prays with expectation. Hallelujah. This is the prayer that brings effect. Amen. He went up into the mountain. Amen. On his own, with a servant who he was sending to look for an answer. Amen. Elijah was a man like us, but he prayed with fervency. He prayed with intensity, but he also prayed with expectation. Amen. As he was praying, he was sending out a man to look for an answer. Is the rain coming? One time, two times, three times, four times, until the seventh time, there is a cloud the size of a man's hand. Amen. The Bible talks about that when we read in the Amplified Version, that the heartfelt continued prayer. Hallelujah. Elijah prayed a total of seven times until his answer came. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. So Elijah was a man of fervent prayer. He was a man of continued prayer. He was a man of great expectation in prayer. Praise the name of Jesus. And to get context of why Elijah prayed in this way, we have to look at Deuteronomy chapter number 11 verse 16. Bible says that, be careful or you will be enticed to turn away and worship other gods and bow down to them then the Lord's anger will burn against you, and he will shut up the heavens so that it will not rain, and the ground will yield no produce, and you will soon perish from the good land the Lord is giving you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And so the Bible here in the book of Deuteronomy, as Moses gives the law to the children of Israel, he says that if you ever worship idols, if you ever worship foreign gods, God will shut the heavens and he will cut you off from the land. So in the time of Israel, that Elijah is prophet, the people have gone after Baal and they are worshiping Baal. Hallelujah. And so as they worship the Baal, the Bible tells us that Elijah rises up and he begins to pray, but he's not praying from nowhere. This is the basis of his prayer, that God said if the people would worship foreign gods, he would shut the heavens. And so he prayed with intensity, but his basis was Deuteronomy 11 verse 16. His basis was the word of God. So the effectual fervent prayer is a fervent prayer. It is an intense prayer. It is a prayer with feeling, but it is a prayer that is based in the word of God, like Elijah prayed. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. So even when he prayed the second time for heaven to be opened, it was God who said to him, go and present yourself before Ahab and I will send rain. So effectual fervent prayers are not just emotional prayers, but they are prayers that are based in the word of God, that are offered with emotion, that are offered with fervency and intensity based on the word of God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So when we find Elijah in the public square saying that there will be no rain for the space of 3.5 years, amen, it's because he has offered effectual fervent prayers. Hallelujah. When he says to the people that there is going to be rain, or he tells Ahab that there is going to be rain, go and tell Ahab there is going to be rain. Go tell him that he must run into the city before he's overrun by the rain. Hallelujah. He makes those bold declarations because he is a man of intense prayer. Hallelujah. It's not just the declarations that have power, but those declarations are underwritten by effectual fervent prayer. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. What is it that backs up your declarations? Amen. What is it that backs up your confessions? The things that you say, Elijah's declarations were underwritten by effectual fervent prayer. He says, go and tell him that rain is coming. Why? Because he had prayed an effectual fervent prayer. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And so when the Bible talks about this effectual fervent prayer, it says that this kind of prayer, if there is a righteous man who can pray effectually and fervently, amen, he prays a prayer that makes power available. It's a prayer that avails power. Amen. And when the Bible is talking about that, it makes tremendous it avails much, or it makes tremendous of power available. It's told the word there is talking about prayers that make a power available, that produce power that brings effect. Amen. Hallelujah. Power that produces miracles. So if there is a man to pray a fervent prayer, power to produce miracles is released. Amen. The power to prevail against spiritual enemies is released. Amen. The force to be effective, producing results, is released. Amen. This is the kind of power that is evidenced by extraordinary deeds. Amen. And so when we're talking about effectual fervent prayer, we're talking about prayers that bring forth effect because of power, prayers that bring forth change, prayers that drive away spiritual enemies, prayers that prevail against all challenges, prayers that are capable of producing the desired outcome. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. These are effectual fervent prayers that make power, tremendous power, power for change, power for results, power for open doors, power for healing, power for promotion, power for victory. Hallelujah. Because of effectual fervent prayers. Hallelujah. As I close this evening, we just want to look at the scripture that we have here, the appropriateness of the illustration that James gives us of the man of prayer, Elijah. Amen. The Bible says the righteous man, we find out the righteous man, that anyone who is a believer in Jesus is a righteous man, who has just to add intensity, fervency, and expectation to their prayers. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. And power will be released. Amen. Now, one of the challenges that we have in prayer is that many people do not believe in their own prayers. Amen. We talked about prayer believers outsourcing prayers because they don't feel that their prayers have any effect. Amen. And so the design of James by the Holy Spirit here is to show us that that is the error of a praying people, to believe that other people have more power or traction in prayer more than themselves. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So the Bible says that Elijah was a man just like us. That's why I labored in the beginning to quote many versions of the Bible which talk about Elijah was a man with a nature like us. Elijah was flesh and blood. Elijah was of like passions. Elijah was just a human being, a man like us. Hallelujah. Subject to like passions like us, hungry like us. Amen. He could be intimidated like us. Jezebel said that I'm going to kill you. He runs away. Just a man like us. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The Bible, I know that in some circles, some people are trying to glorify other people so that it seems that there are prayers of other people that have more power than other people. Amen. If they have more power, probably it's because of their faith and because of their fervency. Hallelujah. But not because of who they are. Amen. Because we are standing on equal footing on the righteousness of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All we have to do is be expectant, have faith, and be fervent in our prayers. Amen. Hallelujah. And so the Bible says that Elijah's prayers were effective, not because he was a prophet of God Most High. No. The Bible says that Elijah was a man just like us. Amen. Praise the Lord. So it makes us understand that anyone who is of a like passion, amen, God does not specialize, or the Apostle James does not specialize this man and say that these are the kinds of prayers that apostles pray. No. He says that Elijah was a man just like us. He's a man like you, man like me. Hallelujah. Just a human being like you. But the difference is that he prayed with fervency. He prayed with expectation, standing on the word of God, that God, you said that if the people who sin, you will shut heaven. Hallelujah. And so he stood on that and he prayed. And when he prayed, he came out into the public square and made a declaration based on his fervent prayer. Praise the name of Jesus. So there is much power that God is waiting for us to release in this season, even to direct that power concerning our nation in the midst of this pandemic. I believe that the power of this virus can be broken and will be broken, is being broken by the prayers of the just that are offering not indifferent prayers. People who are not just saying prayers for the nation, let's say a prayer for the nation, and their minds are not even in it, their heart is not in it. But we're talking about in this hour, we are looking for people whose heart is in the mandate of God, whose heart is saying that, God, you said that the Son of Man would be made manifest to destroy the works of the evil one. And we are praying with our hearts in it, with our hearts going out to the nation that the pandemic may be broken, our hearts going out to the sick that they may be healed, our hearts going towards the church that it may continue to advance and save souls in this hour, our hearts going out to our families, to those who are in a difficult situation in this hour because they are unable to go to work. Effectual fervent prayers, hallelujah, from people of like passions, from human beings, from people with weaknesses, from people who get tired, from people who sometimes get afraid, from people who sometimes feel discouragement, people of like passions who believe the word of God and stand on the word of God, who stand in expectation that their prayers will be answered because they are the righteousness of God and they are praying with feeling and emotion. Hallelujah. And so this evening, my encouragement and my exhortation as we continue to pray, that let's not just go through the motions of prayer, because it's not just the prayers of the righteous, it's the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous that makes power available. Praise the Lord. And so if you have been praying and you've just been going through the motions of prayer, add your effectual and add fervency to your prayers. Hallelujah. The Bible says that, you know what, Jesus is quite an encouragement for all of us, because the Bible says that in his days on the earth, he offered up fervent prayers with loud cries. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I know that sometimes it's not every time that we offer with loud cries, but it shows you that there is something about a fervent prayer. Hallelujah. If the master would engage in fervent prayers, who are we not to be fervent in our prayers? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. He prayed until his sweat became like clots of blood. Amen. It's not in the sweating. Amen. But it's in the heart. Hallelujah. The pouring out of the heart. Like Hannah says, that I have poured my soul before him. Hallelujah. I have poured my heart before him. I am in my prayer. Hallelujah. My prayer is not apart from me, that you know you can pray and your prayer is there and you're looking at your prayer. No. You are right in your prayer. Hallelujah. And your prayer is you. Amen. Praise the Lord. And you are pouring. May we pour our hearts before God concerning our nation, concerning our families, concerning our children, concerning all the things that pertain to us in this season, because there is a prayer that brings forth effect, and you can pray it and bring forth results. May we not be robbed of the potentials of your prayer, because you are a righteous man. All you need is to be effectual and fervent in your prayer, and we will have tremendous power available for our church, tremendous power available for our nation, tremendous power available for anything that we desire if we can pray, because we are the righteousness of God. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus. We bless you, oh God. We thank you for this grace that we can pray prayers with effect, oh God, that our effectual fervent prayers, they make power available. And we thank you that power is being made available to heal bodies right now. Power is being made available to open doors in the name of Jesus. Power is being made available to restore lives, to restore relationships, to restore, mighty God, in the name of Jesus, oh God, health. We thank you that power is made available, oh God, to bring businesses, oh God, to life in the name of Jesus. We speak this upon the lives of your people in the name of Jesus, oh God. We give you glory and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Have a good night. May the Lord continue to bless you and keep you and preserve you in this hour. We are praying for you, and we believe that God will continue to preserve you and bless you even in this season. In Jesus' name, amen.